Sangan.
At sa pagbabalik ng Pasig River Ferry System,
ito ka, ulo lang po.
Hangad ni Kapitan Ronnie ay magtuloy-tuloy ng walang aberya ang kanilang biyahe.
This is the Philippines. We are ANC.
Voter registration for next year's elections extended until the end of October. The Okta Research Group sees a Merry Christmas for Filipinos with a decline in COVID-19 infections. Senator Risa Ontiveros accused of bribing a formerly pharmaceutical employee by the lawyer of the firm's detained director, Lincoln Ong. And more college programs set for limited face-to-face classes. The chairman of the Commission on Higher Education, Prospero De Vera, joins us later on in the program. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Thanks for joining us, and for those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad you could join us today. We begin with this story. Some political analysts believe Vice President Lenny Robredo should run for president. Ateneo de Manila Professor Edmond Taya and UP Professor Jean Franco say Robredo has long been the face of the opposition. Franco, however, says Robredo should still continue to unify non-administration bets.
Whether she runs or not, she will be a major, a campaign manager, a major player in the 2022 elections, because she's the only one who can claim to be the real opposition. I think it's something that she has to discuss with her party mates and supporters, no?
Taya also says Robredo already has the upper hand among the non-administration bets.
Nakita din naman natin, marami din naman nagawa ang VP Lenny, ano? Kung tutusin, lalo na nitong pandemya. And so, whatever is the reason why she's not picking up is something that they really have to determine. Actually, all the more na dapat tumakbo si VP Lenny, kasi alam mo, the more the number of candidates there are, the more divided the votes will be, no? And therefore, the better chance that she has.
Labor leader Leody De Guzman running for president in next year. De Guzman on Tuesday accepted the nomination of Partido Lakas ng Masa and various progressive organizations. De Guzman ran for senator back in 2019 but lost. His advocacy remains the same, changing the system and pushing for workers' rights.
Kailangan change. Hindi lang palitan si Duterte. Hindi lang para palitan yung mukha ng Pangulo sa Malacanang, kundi dapat palitan ang buong sistema ng ating gobyerno. Dapat ganung ang ipaliwanag natin sa mga tao. At doon tayo kikilalanin naiiba sa mga politiko na kakandidato ngayon.
The Philippine Senate ratifies a bill postponing the first regular elections in the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao. Senate Committee on a Local Government Chairman Francis Tolentino says moving the BARM elections to May 2025 will give the Bangsamoro Transition Authority enough time to complete its transition process. It will also give the region time to recover from the effects of the pandemic. Tolentino notes the three-year delay was also crucial in making sure the BARM elections would be synchronized with the midterm polls.
I think both houses realized, and including the executive branch, that what we are pursuing here is not just a separate or distinct sui generis parliament, but the notion of peace, which has been the dream of several generations of people living in the area. So there can be no compromise when it comes to peace, because whatever happens in the Bangsamoro would definitely affect the entire country.
Another proof that the late dictator Ferdinand Marcos plundered the Philippines, that's how Bayanmuna Party List representative Carlos Zarate described the Sandigan Bayan's ruling in a case involving the ill-gotten wealth of the Marcos family. The country's anti-graft court ordered Royal Traders Holding, formerly known as Traders Royal Bank, to pay government 96 million pesos and $5.4 million. The amounts are based on the bank certificates recovered from the Marcos family when they were exiled to Hawaii in 1986. The certificates were later awarded to the Philippines by the U.S. District Court of Hawaii. But the bank, which was allegedly owned by the Marcoses, had refused to encash them back in 1993.
This debunks the revisionist narrative of the Marcos loyalists, no? The Marcos family and his cronies did not commit plunder and had no ill-gotten wealth, no? During the time that the dictator was in Malacañang. We have to continue pursuing this, no? Because at the latest data provided to us by the PCGG, ang na-recover pa lang talaga natin, no? Halos ano na 35 years after EDSA, 174 billion pesos, no, or roughly $3.4 billion, and according to some records, more or less $10 billion yung na-plunder ng Marcos family and his cronies. So we have a long way to go to recover all this ill-gotten wealth.
A statement supposedly penned and signed by formerly executive Criselle Mago makes its way to the internet. That's after several days of no contact with the Senate following her admission her firm swindled the government in their multi-billion peso pandemic supply deals. A screen grab of an email, allegedly from Mago, was shared by formerly corporation's media coordinator. It states Mago is supposedly still trying to process what's happening, but the contact number provided isn't accepting any calls and only responding through text message. The Senate Blue Ribbon Committee also says Mago's alleged statement was never sent to them. The Philippines recorded 13,846 more COVID-19 infections Tuesday. It's the lowest daily tally in nearly a month. This was the result of the low testing output of some laboratories. Active cases now stand at 132,000. Meanwhile, the death toll climbed to over 37,600. The province of Batanes records its second COVID-19 death. The provincial government says an 88-year-old man from the town of Basco died of COVID-19, though the underlying cause has yet to be determined. Batanes also logged 41 new COVID-19 cases last Thursday, bringing the total number of active infections to more than 450. The island is under enhanced community quarantine until October 4 due to a recent spike in infections. The Okta Research Group is optimistic the COVID-19 situation in the Philippines will improve by the fourth quarter of this year. COVID-19 cases in Metro Manila are projected to decrease in December, which could pave the way for the region to be placed under a lower alert level. The group adds, the implementation of the alert level scheme has been effective.
Tingin natin talaga maganda yung outlook natin for the fourth quarter of 2021. By December, tingin natin talaga mababa na yung bilang na kaso sa NCR. Yes, ngayon may mga areas pa, mga probinsya na nagsisimula pa lang or nagkaka-surge pa lang sila. Tumataas pa lang yung bilang ng kaso. Meron sa Region 2, meron sa Region 1, meron sa Region 6, meron sa Region 5. So itong mga areas na ito, syempre kailangan tutukan natin. Pero, ano naman tayo, optimistic tayo sa fourth quarter natin for our businesses and for the economy.
But for Marikina City Mayor Marcelino Teodoro, it's better to ramp up testing and wait for more data before downgrading the alert level in Metro Manila.
Kailangan ang sinasabi ng mga mayor ay maitaas yung bilang ng natetest na mga kaso upang sa ganun talagang may consistency na masasabing bumababa talaga yung mga kaso ng case transmission natin.
Malacanang now urging parents to start registering their children for the COVID-19 vaccine rollout. That's after President Rodrigo Duterte approved the inoculation of children and the general population beginning next month. The health department says children aged 12 and above with comorbidities will be prioritized. Vaccine Chief Carlito Galvez Jr. says government plans to administer 55 million COVID jabs by next month, or up to 800,000 doses per day. Some cities in Metro Manila have already begun registering minors for vaccination.
Nakaumang na po para in the event po itong October, kapag sinabi niyo po kanina, ay nakahanda na po kami ng listahan po namin para sa mga estudyante po namin.
Some 20.5 million Filipinos have been fully vaccinated against COVID-19 so far. That's about 26.69% of the government's target by the end of the year. And breaking news this noon, we have this just in. Philippine boxing icon turned Senator Manny Pacquiao has hanged up his gloves. The 42-year-old Pacquiao announced his retirement from boxing following a legendary career that saw him become the sport's only 8-division champion. The Pac-Man's decision comes as he prepares for a run at the presidency next year. And take a break now. Up ahead, the palace approves limited face-to-face classes for more college programs. We'll tackle that when Dateline Philippines returns. Stay with us here on ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
the greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
We are back. You're still with Dateline Philippines here on ANC. Here's another look at our headlines this noon. Filipino boxing legend turned Senator Manny Pacquiao retires from boxing as he guns for the presidency next year. Voter registration for next year's elections extended until the end of October. The Okta Research Group sees a Merry Christmas for Filipinos with a decline in COVID-19 infections. Senator Risa Ontiveros accused of bribing a formerly pharmaceutical employee by the lawyer of the firm's detained director, Lincoln Ong. More college programs set for limited face-to-face classes. Back with more news, the Commission on Elections has approved the extension of voter registration for next year's polls, which has been marred by long lines due to health restrictions amid this pandemic. Our correspondent Ina Reformina now joins us with details. Ina, go ahead.
Yes, Casey, in today's Anbang session, which, by the way, is still ongoing, the Commission on Elections voted to extend the period for voter registration. COMELEC spokesman James Jimenez says the extension is from October 11 to 30. Again, that's from October 11 to 30, Mondays to Fridays, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. Now, there will be no Saturday registration. Right now, there is voter registration during Saturdays and holidays, but from October 11 to 30, there will be no Saturday voter registration. Only Mondays through Fridays will the COMELEC be accepting applications for voter registration. Now, except for the last day, which is on October 30, that is a Saturday, COMELEC offices and satellite mall registrations will be open from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. to process registrations. Now, all registration services will be offered. This means first-time voters, registration for transfer of address, reactivation of delisted or deactivated voters, and correction of entries such as change of address and change in civil status. Now, Carmina, from October 1 to 8, there will be no registration because these days are dedicated for the filing of certificates of candidacy for candidates who will be running in the May 9, 2022 elections. That is why resumption of voter registration past September 30 will be on October 11. Now, as for overseas voter registration, this is extended for only 2 weeks, and that is from October 1 to 14. Overseas voters are not affected by the filing of POCs. That is why the extension of voter registration for overseas voting will commence immediately on October 1, but will only be for 2 weeks. All COMELEC online platforms for appointments and downloading of forms will also remain available during the extension period. That is the latest news that we have from the Commission on Elections. Ina Reformina, ABS-CBN News.
Yes, Ina, a couple of questions for you before we let you go. We do know that the COMELEC previously has said they're not going to extend specifically because of the schedule that they need to follow. And now that we have this extension, what will be the effect on the schedule of the commission regarding the 2022 polls, Ina?
Yes, Carmina, a good thing that you asked that. If I failed to mention that the management committee meeting, which transpired last Monday morning, well, actually in that meeting, a majority of election officers nationwide were opposed to an extension beyond a one-week extension period after the filing of POC, because the timelines will be severely affected, including the preparation of the project of precincts and voters' lists. But in the course of the discussion of that management committee meeting, the consensus was raised that they had to respond to the clamor for an extension, or the timelines would be greatly affected, and the slack time also has been dipped into for each timeline. For example, for each preparation for the elections, that will be severely affected. But they had to do this. They really had to make do with this period, because a lot of people are still lining up, and we really cannot disenfranchise voters, according to the COMELEC. Now, regarding the preparations, the logistics, that is severely affected. We have not been given yet what adjustments will be made. Definitely, there will be some delays, like in the printing of ballots. There will be delays also in the delivery of supplies and equipment, but still within a reasonable time, as much as possible, according to the commission. Casey?
All right, we got that. Ina Reformina there joining us on the line. Take care, Ina. You keep safe. And moving on, the Philippine government aims to begin the COVID-19 vaccination of 12 to 17-year-olds by October 15. Health Undersecretary Mirna Cabotaje says they will prioritize children with comorbidities and other immunodeficiencies. She also notes authorities are looking into kicking off pediatric vaccinations in hospitals in the National Capital Region.
Pagkatapos ng dalawang linggo, ito yung tinatawag na test run ay dadalhin na natin sa iba't ibang rehiyon. Kagaya nung pag-umpisa natin yung pagbabakuna ng COVID-19, di ba? Inumpisahan natin sa mga COVID referral hospital, tinignan natin kung ano yung mga kailangan bantayan, yung tinatawag natin simulation, and then nag-expand na tayo sa iba't ibang hospital.
Meanwhile, Cabotaje has set a more ambitious target for the country's vaccination drive by next month. She says government is aiming to administer 800,000 to 1 million doses daily. President Rodrigo Duterte allows limited face-to-face classes for more college programs. The Commission on Higher Education says this will be allowed in colleges and universities that are located in areas under the loosest lockdown. It will take effect in degree courses that require hands-on experience. These include engineering and technology, hotel and restaurant management, tourism and travel management, and maritime courses. Duterte also recently authorized the pilot test of face-to-face classes in basic education. And CHED Chairman Prospero De Vera expects the start of face-to-face classes for the additional programs to begin as early as this semester. He joins us now for a discussion on that. Chairman, good afternoon to you. Nice to see you. Thanks for joining us today.
Hi, good afternoon, Carmina, and good afternoon to all your viewers.
All right. How significant will this be, not just for the students, but also when we talk about the productivity of these students once they're done with university in the future post-pandemic? Chairman.
Well, the impact of this will be big because, number one, it shows that the first batch of degree programs that we allowed, the guidelines were strict and the infection was very minimal, meaning the system is in place already. And the schools are getting to do the or to use the system better every month and every day that they continue. So we have a next batch. Second, it is important because engineering and technology programs are one of the biggest degree programs in higher education institutions in terms of the number of students and universities involved. Also, the other programs like maritime programs are very important because it has implications on our role as a major supplier of seafarers all over the world. And so this next batch is crucial. We have to make sure it works. And we have to make sure that the students learn the competencies that they need through the face-to-face classes that will be handled.
And tell us about the process here, because obviously you didn't just choose these courses out of thin air. There was an in-depth look at it, not just here while the pandemic is happening, but also in terms of productivity later on in the future, Chairman.
Yes, our approach to limited face-to-face is different from DepEd. Our approach is to look at degree programs that really need face-to-face classes. You know, it's different because in basic ed, you just have one curriculum for all the students. But in higher ed, you have degree programs all over. And therefore, we started at the degree programs, number one, that really need skills-based training. That's number one. Number two, we look at degree programs that will allow for limited face-to-face easily, meaning you can tweak the curriculum, you can tweak the syllabus so that you can easily identify which subjects will require face-to-face, which subjects can be delivered online or offline. And then, of course, we looked at the impact of these degree programs on our manpower requirements, both domestic and international. And so we started looking at the degree programs, evaluating them, and then we mobilized the technical panels, the experts, the deans of the schools to develop a flexible learning curriculum and flexible learning syllabus. And once this flexible system has been approved by the Commission and Bank, that is the time that we went to the IATF and asked for approval. You know, it's very dangerous to just allow degree programs to open if there are no flexible curriculum documents, because universities might implement it differently. Mm-hmm. So we want to make sure that once it is approved, all the universities that will do limited face-to-face will do it the same way. The learning competencies will be achieved. The face-to-face classes will be standardized in terms of what subjects will need face-to-face. Mm-hmm. And so we're moving program by program as we go along. That is the approach that we have adopted in higher education.
Yeah, tell me something, Chairman. How alarmed were you when it was apparent that the threat was not just on the health and learning capabilities of the students, but also on the economic development of the nation later on, that also was being threatened by this pandemic in terms of churning out these graduates later on? Go ahead, Chairman.
Well, we were very, very alarmed because we were monitoring how flexible learning was being implemented. We were talking with the deans of the schools, listening to the students, and we can identify already the degree programs where, you know, hands-on courses are non-negotiable. Like, for example, in the field of medicine and allied health, if you don't allow the students in medicine, nursing, and the others to do clinical rotation, they will not develop the skills on how to deal with patients. It's very dangerous because even assuming that they pass the licensure, they might not turn out to be good doctors and they're dealing with human lives. So we cannot take the risk. Now, this second batch, for example, for maritime programs, some of the international shipping companies have already sent letters to our university saying, if you don't allow your students to do shipboard training, we will give the quota to other countries. You know, that's very, very risky because we will lose the capacity to produce seafarers. And so there is urgency really to prioritize certain programs compared to the others. I have been asked repeatedly, why not all the degree programs? Because we have to make sure safety is never compromised. We have to make sure that when we implement it, the assurance of safety is there. That's why we have to move slow. And the universities also are very cautious in doing limited face-to-face.
Talking about that, what's your assessment of how these universities have responded, have adjusted to make sure that the goal is met, that eventually there will be face-to-face classes sooner rather than later, Chairman?
It's a continuous learning experience, both for the universities, for the students, the faculty, and even for the commission. Because remember, there are no experts in this area. The whole world is trying to find solutions. And so we just have to continuously learn. For example, the original universities that had limited face-to-face and retrofitted their campuses, they continue to tweak the retrofitting based on their experience and based on what they do as benchmarking with other universities. So this next batch of schools that will do retrofitting will already benefit from the experience of retrofitting of the first batch of schools that did it in January. Because even the medical explanation for transmission has been changing. Remember, Carmina, before it was said that, surfaces, the virus will attach itself to surfaces, etc. Yeah. You have to spray everything, etc. Now in Delta, they're saying the primary mode of transmission is through the air.
Correct.
And so even the way we approach retrofitting is going to change because we now have to look at how the air flow inside the classrooms.
Yeah. In fact, that's a major discussion at this point, not just for universities, but businesses as well, because if we're going to welcome people back into these establishments, you got to make sure that it's safe for them. The ventilation is there. I want to ask you about the amount of money that's going into this. Would you have any idea as to the retrofitting costs, Chairman?
I don't have the exact figures, but it changes because of the medical science or the researches and findings that are coming out. In some of the schools that I visited, for example, in Zamboanga, like the Universidad de Zamboanga for their dentistry program, they have already put machines to filter the air in every classroom, aside from opening the windows, putting blowers to move the air in one direction, etc. So in those instances, costs would be a factor because you'll have to buy new machines. Where previously, you just opened the windows, had big blowers to move the air one way, put directional signs. So it is continuously evolving and adapting. And so this is the trend that we are seeing. What we're doing with the schools is that the good schools, we ask them to videotape everything they're doing and then we distribute it to all the other schools.
So best practices.
Yes, we always look at best practices. Like Our Lady of Fatima had a very good retrofitting system previously. Now the Universidad de Zamboanga, to me, is now the benchmark as far as retrofitting is concerned. Mm-hmm. In their classroom, because they have a dentistry program, there is literally no contact between the teacher and the student because everything is electronic. When they work on the mannequins, on filling up the teeth of the mannequins, it is flashed on the screen so everybody can do it, and it is seen by their teachers in another room. Mm-hmm. So, they've created the system where literally there is no contact between students and teachers, and that is another level of safety that will protect our students and teachers.
Here's the thing though, Chairman, because we talk about opening these limited face-to-face programs to increase productivity in the future, but the quality of graduates may not be the same because of the preparedness of a specific university. It's not going to be the same for all. You just described that. So how do you then fill that gap? How do you solve that disconnect?
Well, we will only be able to determine that maybe in a year or two after we look at the results of the graduates. I think it is impossible to conclude on that now. What we have is anecdotal evidence and observations. But what we're doing is that the deans of the different schools, deans of medicine, for example, deans of engineering, must continue the conversations, look at best practices, compare notes. I think that is non-negotiable as far as the higher education system is concerned. We must bring the experts in. It requires a lot of work, a lot of Zoom sessions, a lot of meetings, but that is the only way by which we can do adjustments.
Yeah.
Because if we see that certain system works in other schools, the other school should adopt it. Only through bayanihan, only through working together, can we address it. Because we benchmark not only with what is happening here, but with also what is happening in other countries. A lot of the Zoom sessions being done by the CHED regional offices now include talks of universities in other countries on how they are also adapting. So if there are things that we can learn, we should learn it fast. We should implement it fast. I think that's the only thing we can do now until we're able to really control the pandemic.
Yeah, and you can't just do that on your own, right? You can't, you know, go through all of these alone without any specific goal in mind. I'm curious about your communication, the kind of relationship you now have with NEDA Secretary General Carl Chua, for example, because, you know, we're dealing with a pandemic right now, but he's dealing with, you know, years down the line, what's going to happen if things go unchanged. Tell us about the conversations you've been having with him, Chairman.
Well, there are certain realistic, things that we have to accept. The fact that all departments are trying to grapple with the pandemic. And so the time allowed for really very good in-depth discussion is quite limited. A lot of it happens in the IATF when we discuss among the cabinet members and the experts. And a lot of this are done at the lower levels of bureaucracy because the secretaries, you know, their schedules are really tight and, you know, having an in-depth Zoom discussion may not be possible. But the lower levels, the undersecretaries, the directors, are the ones who are doing a lot of the discussions because they're the ones that provide the guidelines that will be issued by agencies. Mm-hmm. For example, in DOH, we have very good discussions with Mia Nakabutahe, who is the one that handles a lot of the vaccination. So she talks continuously with the directors of the different CHED offices. What is brought to me is already the collaborative work of a lot of the bureaucrats, the different offices. Mm-hmm. I think we have to rely and we have to really use the expertise of everyone in the bureaucracy to be able to address these problems.
Chairman, you mentioned vaccination just a couple of seconds ago. Is it going to be, I know there's a discussion about it being mandatory. We know the issues surrounding that, but having a fully vaccinated university, for example, how significant will that be if we were to, you know, assess the learning capabilities and eventually the absorption of these students later on?
We have been monitoring the vaccination levels at the university level, and they have been submitting reports to CHED. No? This Friday, I will be meeting with the presidents of the universities to exactly discuss this. The good news is there are many universities where their vaccination levels are way above 70% already, not just for faculty, employees, but also students. This is because in the first batch of face-to-face, we were able to work with the Department of Health to classify the medical and allied health faculty and students as essential health workers. Mm-hmm. So they were classified as A1.
Yeah.
Okay. Number two, in April, I fought in the IATF to upgrade the education frontliners from B1 to A4. So they are in the A4 list, all faculty and employees. And then all the students in higher education, because they're 18 years old and above, are actually part of the general vaccination group. So we're working already on that. And so for universities that have very good relationship with their local governments, they have been pushing and getting everyone in the school vaccinated. So I was surprised when the reports came in. Some universities have vaccinated way above 70%. They're now in the 80 and even 90%.
So after this second batch, Chairman, do you think that, you know, they're going to go back to universities or going to welcome faculty and students as early as next year? Is that possible?
Well, it depends on what the universities will adopt as the appropriate flexible learning policy. You know, one good thing about COVID, if ever there is a silver lining, is that many universities have learned how to use technology in teaching. They're now using technology-mediated learning. So the faculty members are more adept now at using technology. The students are more adept. There are better materials to be used on virtual or online learning. So many of the universities, especially those that have invested in technology a long time ago, done distance learning, are going full speed ahead to do more online than face-to-face. Mm. And this includes universities like La Salle, UST, Ateneo, UP. The bigger batch are now adjusting to a combination of online and face-to-face or offline and face-to-face. For example, in campuses that are in far-flung areas, it is not cost-effective to invest in technology because the signal is so weak, you cannot buy strong signal anyway. So even if you put fiber optics all over the campus, if the technology or the signal is weak, you still cannot do online classes. So what they're thinking of is using their money to retrofit their campuses, and they will have a combination of offline and face-to-face. Mm-hmm. So for example, students will go to class for 1 week straight, only one-third of the class. 30% will do 1 week and then do offline for 2 weeks. On the second week, the next 30% will go to class for 1 week and then go home for 2 weeks. And the third batch will go on the third week and go home for 2 weeks. So effectively, you have reduced the number of students in the classroom, you know, by 70% by doing a combination of modules and face-to-face.
All right.
This is what is evolving now in different universities across the country.
It's good. You're painting a very good, vibrant, dynamic picture of the sector in our conversation. Before we let you go, I just want to ask you if you have a number, Chairman. Do we know how many universities will be included in this second batch of opening up limited face-to-face classes? Do you have a number to that?
Well, they're only applying now, so I wouldn't know the number. But we anticipate that this will be bigger from the first batch because engineering and technology degree programs are the biggest block of programs in higher education. So it should be much bigger than that. The other thing, Carmina, is that Secretary Galvez and I have already discussed aggressively pushing for the full vaccination of all education frontliners and students who will do face-to-face. The DOH, Mirna Kabutahe, has already issued a circular 3 days ago, again pushing for vaccination of teachers and education personnel.
Yeah.
And that's why this Friday, we are now doing a hard inventory of all those who have not been vaccinated. So we target for full vaccination of all education personnel and then target the students next. With the increased number of vaccines, we're targeting that for the next 2 months, we should aggressively push for vaccination in higher education institutions.
Well, glad to know that things are looking up. Ched, Chairman there, Prospero Devera, thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. Take care and you keep safe.
Thank you, Carmina. Thank you.
And from there, we're going to take a break now. Still ahead, the World Health Organization vows to punish its employees linked to sexual abuse incidents in Congo. This is Dateline Philippines. You're watching ANC.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
More news. Philippine Senator Rita Ontiveros accused of bribing an employee of formerly pharmaceutical Ferdinand Topacio. The legal counsel of detained official Lincoln Ong released a video of a formerly employee refuting allegations hurled against the firm. That employee said a warehouse staff was bribed by the camp of Ontiveros to tarnish formerly and its head of regulatory affairs, Crisel Mago. Topacio says they are studying filing charges against the senator and those involved.
Ang importante rito, money change hands. According to the witness, it was given by a member of the staff of Senator Ontiveros, that is according to the witness, ha? At ang nag-ibot ay driver, a certain Ryan Tasso. That is all we have. These are all factual. Hindi po namin sinasabing ito ay totoo. It is not our place to say that whether this is true or not. Our place is to bring this to the attention of the proper authorities and for them to conduct an investigation. And if warranted, file the appropriate charges against Senator Riz Ontiveros, yung nag-abot po na lawyer at yung driver niya. It is not the place of the Blue Ribbon to conduct criminal investigations, but only investigations in aid of legislation. huwag tayong manira ng kapwa natin dito, ha? That is the role of the courts.
Senator Ontiveros' camp said she will hold a press conference Thursday to answer this allegation during the Senate's probe into government's pandemic spending. Mago confirmed the statement of a formerly employee that they tampered with face shields bought by government for health workers. World News Now, the chief of the World Health Organization vows to punish WHO employees involved in sexual abuse incidents during an Ebola crisis in Congo. Here's the full story.
The World Health Organization is heartbroken, its regional director for Africa has said, after an independent commission found that 21 out of 83 alleged perpetrators of sex abuse in Democratic Republic of Congo were employed by the WHO. Dr. Matsidiso Moeti was speaking at a media briefing on Tuesday.
We in WHO are indeed humbled, horrified, and heartbroken by the findings of this inquiry. I'd like also to thank all the women and girls who have come forward and given evidence to the investigation, and thus have given us the basis on which to take action in WHO, which has been necessary.
The commission found that the abuse, including 9 allegations of rape, were committed by both national and international staff. The report said alleged victims were also not provided with the necessary support and assistance required for such degrading experiences. In an investigation published last year by the Thomson Reuters Foundation and The New Humanitarian, more than 50 women accused aid workers from the WHO and leading charities of demanding sex in exchange for jobs during the 2018 to 2020 Ebola crisis. WHO Director General Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus said the commission's report made for harrowing reading.
I'm sorry for what was done to you by people who were employed by WHO to serve and protect you. I'm sorry for the ongoing suffering that this event must cause. I'm sorry that you have had to relieve them in talking to the Commission about your experiences.
Tedros said the organization will ban those identified as perpetrators from future employment with the WHO and would notify the broader UN system. He said the WHO was terminating the contracts of 4 people identified as perpetrators who were still employed by the agency when it was made aware of the allegations against them.
And before we go, we again bring you this piece of breaking news. Philippine boxing icon turned Senator Manny Pacquiao has hanged up his gloves. The 42-year-old Pacquiao announced his retirement from boxing following a legendary career that saw him become the sport's only 8th division champion. Pacquiao thanked his family, fans, and people who molded him into a world-class fighter like Hall of Famer Freddie Roach and longtime trainer Buboy Fernandez. He said, "It was a difficult decision to make." The Pac-Man's decision comes as he prepares for a run at the presidency next year.
It is difficult for me to accept that my time as a boxer is over. Today, I am announcing my retirement. I never thought that this day would come. As I hang up my boxing gloves, I would like to thank the whole world, especially the Filipino people, for supporting Manny Pacquiao. Goodbye, boxing. Thank you for changing my life. When my family was desperate, you give us hope. You give me the chance to fight our way out of poverty. Because of you, I was able to inspire people all over the world. Because of you, I have been given the courage to change more lives. I just heard the final bell. Tapos na ang boxing. Maraming salamat po sa inyong lahat. God is gold all the time. Thank you.
And that'll do it for today. Thank you for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, Dateline Philippines podcast is on Spotify and Apple Podcasts. Playback this newscast too on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.